Okay, fine. Very well.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. We would like to welcome everyone back to day two of the 12th Global Social Business Day. And what an incredible, impactful start it has been. The opening session had an illustrious group of individuals who decided to grace the occasions. We had the likes of His Excellency Jose Ramos Horta, 1996 Nobel Peace Laureate and the current president of East Timor. Timor-Leste, we had the president of International Olympic Committee, Thomas Bach, among many other dignitaries who provided a very clear message on the importance of this on the importance of this conference that we have in hand about rebuilding and reshaping the civilization. There were 5 plenary sessions held across a number of topics. We had glimpses of social businesses which are live, which are being run as we speak. And to top it all off, we had an incredible viewership on across all the 5 or multiple social media channels. And we deeply appreciate all the participants who have joined us via Zoom and other links as well. More importantly, just a quick reminder for everyone about the housekeeping rules for the day. Again, all participants who are joining via Zoom, as you move from one session to the other, please note that you'll have to revert back to your Zoom ticket, join through the lobby, and speakers, if you have any technical issues, please feel free to reach out to your relevant contact points for the UNIS Center. And again, all sessions, all the panel sessions and the glimpses sessions today are being timed. So we request all speakers to be, and moderators as well, to be please mindful of the speaking times. Mr. Bell would be playing, would be coming back to playing in order as well. And 60 seconds prior to the ending of the allocated times, you will hear the bell being rung. And once it's finished, it will be rung again. Now, without further ado, without keeping ourselves for too long, I would like to invite Professor Cam Donaldson, who's the UNIS Chair and Distinguished Professor of Health Economics at the UNIS Center for Social Business and Health at Glasgow Caledonian University. Cam has been one of the stalwarts of the academia movement. In fact, he's seen it grow and contributed significantly in its growth as we know today. And he would be moderating the first session, which is the Plenary 6, Healthcare for New Civilization. Before handing over to Cam, I would like all our audiences and viewers to please continue to stay on. There is a significant surprise at the end of this panel. So please do continue to stay tuned as we finish this. Now, before that, Cam, over to you.
Very many thanks, Prometheus. That's a very intriguing invitation that you have just issued. So building a new civilization, at the very core of that is always, I think, going to be issues to do with the future of health and the future of healthcare. And COVID has exposed further the fatal consequences of both healthcare inequality, with a lack of collective action against disease prevention, for example, but also health inequality, whereby a lack of action on access to some of the basics of life has really knock-on effects on people's health and well-being, food being a perfect example. So what is the place as we move forward of social business in all of this? So that's the purpose of the panel today, is to consider that question from a whole range of really interesting perspectives. And I'll introduce the panel as we go along. But of course, we have also a very special guest on the panel, Professor Yunus. I don't know, Professor Yunus, if you want to say just a few words at the beginning at this stage.
Thank you. I'll be delighted to greet everybody into this panel. This is the first panel of the second day and very important session on health, health for new civilization. And today we will be discussing in depth what we mean by that. And I'm very happy that Cam, you are leading this panel. You have dedicated your life on health issues, and you created the UNIS Center for Health and Social Business in Glasgow Caledonian University. I've been leading the whole social business movement in the health direction and the health sector in a very, very sustained way. And you have done lots of research, and I have the pleasure of writing joint articles, op-eds with you on health issues, which have been significant impact on that. So this is important because the pandemic has shown how terrible our civilization, current civilization is. And I highlight the vaccine as a symbol of the failure of the civilization that we are moving through. It has caused, because of the way we have designed the civilization, the fundamentals of the civilization, it has caused innocent people, millions of innocent people, for denying them the access to vaccine. And the vaccine story, I think, is a kind of symbolizes the entire theme, entire procedure of the current civilization. So if you want to build a new civilization, that's where the starting point should be, health. And I look back on my story about the microcredit. As soon as we did the microcredit, a natural step for us was healthcare. We moved into healthcare because it's so natural to each other. And then we moved into the idea of social business. Actually, health issues led us to the creation of the idea of social business. So I would say that the health is the entry point of creating a new civilization. We can take care of all people on the planet on the healthcare side, and we can. There is nothing shortage of anything. We have the technology, we have the able people, we have dedicated, committed staff around the world who want to help people. But somehow, vast majority of people in the world are left out from healthcare. So if we can cover every single human being born on this planet, a guaranteed healthcare of high quality, that's what the new civilization, essence of the new civilization will be. So it's a good hand. Cam will be leading this conversation. And I'm very happy that this is being discussed with such a very important panelist. Thank you very much. Cam, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Professor Yunus, for that excellent introduction. Now, each of our excellent panel members is going to speak for roughly 5 minutes, and I won't hold you back anymore from hearing from them. It really is a fantastic collection of people that you're about to hear from. So our first speaker is Adiba Kamarul Zaman, who's president of the International AIDS Society. Adiba is also Dean of the Faculty of Medicine and Professor of Infectious Diseases at University of Malaya in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Adiba, we are very much looking forward to your first presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, and thank you very much, Professor Yunus and Yunus Center, for inviting me to this illustrious panel. I think we've heard just prior to coming onto the panel the importance of collaboration, and I just want to use the experience from HIV that we've had, as well as COVID-19, to see how we can move forward. The ideas that Professor Yunus and the Yunus Center have in terms of new ways of delivering healthcare, both prevention and treatment. And one, of course, is the importance of collaboration that we talked about, of the People's Vaccine Initiative, as well as the Yunus Center in highlighting the COVID-19 vaccine needs around the world. I'm not really going to touch on the vaccine initiative, but to use the earlier pandemic of HIV, I guess we didn't learn, right? It took us, a good 8 years before we were able to scale up antiretroviral therapy. When the issues of COVID-19 vaccine distribution around the world, we just didn't learn from the hundreds of thousands of people who died from lack of access to antiretroviral. So I guess today's panel is about learning from previous experience and how to move forward. So the lessons learned from HIV would be the importance of collaboration, multi-stakeholder engagement, evidence and rights-based response to the pandemic. And most importantly, I think in the setting of what we want to try and do is community empowerment and engagement, and making the community an essential part of the health system. And I think, although there are many examples around the world, it really isn't, if we look around, at least in my own country, delivery of HIV prevention and others by the community is still pretty much a by the by and not a part of the health ecosystem and really learning from HIV response and COVID-19 response, I think we really need to find a way of making community-led responses truly a part of the health system if we want to move forward. Now, let me give an example, and there are many, many around the world. Of course, scaling up antiretroviral therapy in sub-Saharan Africa wouldn't have been possible without community involvement, task shifting, peer-led antiretroviral or peer-led HIV testing and peer-led antiretroviral delivery. But let me use an example in Malaysia itself. When we decided to implement the needle syringe program, which of course is very controversial in a conservative country like mine, Malaysia, it couldn't be done in a traditional health system. There was a lot of pushback, to deliver clean needles through the ubiquitous Ministry of Health clinics. And so we have to implement it through through peer community-based organizations. But the system is not organized, there is no kind of way to simple things, like even to give a salary to outreach workers, training and accreditation and record keeping. So I think moving forward, these important I'd like to think they're an important arm of the health system, really needs to be organized and structured, like I said, in a formal manner within our health system. So that's just one example in terms of delivering HIV prevention services. And the other example is the use of technology and self-testing, whether it's for HIV, whether it's for HPV to detect HPV infection and eliminate cervical cancer. I think this is another example of ways in which disruption of the health system can lead to good things and a big impact on marginalized and vulnerable population, whether it's people at risk of HIV or whether it's women who won't come forward for cervical pap smear testing for whatever reason. So I think the HIV pandemic and more recently the COVID-19 pandemic have given us many, many examples of ways in which we can empower community-led organizations to deliver very important prevention as well as treatment services that have been traditionally delivered through formal health systems that I believe can not only reach more people, be more impactful, but I'm speaking this in front of a health economist, but more likely to be cost effective as well. So I'd love to hear from others, but I think there are so many lessons to be learned from the last 2 years, 3 years now, and certainly from the last 4 decades of the HIV pandemic for us to really move forward and disrupt health systems in a good way. Thank you very much.
Brilliant. Thanks, Adiba. The more that we can share these examples, the better, I think. Absolutely. So thank you very much for getting us off to a brilliant start. Our next speaker is Jean Berlou, who is president and founder of Jean Berlou Consulting. John also has, I think, over 20 years experience in the food industry, mainly at McCain Foods, and was a well-known company, not only in its own right, of course, but also with respect to its support for socially responsible actions. So, Jean, we're very much looking forward to hearing your perspective on this.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Guy. Good morning, everybody. I have to confess, I'm not at all an health specialist. I'm a social business builder, and I would like to share my experience to show you what can be done in the healthcare field. I spend a major part of my professional life focused on generating the maximum profit for my shareholders. Bottom line was controlling my life. And fortunately, during the last 20 years of my career, I moved to McCain, a family business, selling frozen French fries and appetizers all around the world. I was regional CEO for Continental Europe, Russia, Middle East, and North Africa. But I was also in charge of the development and the implementation of the global company corporate social responsibility strategy. I became very interested in the idea of social business during this period, and I started attending conferences and meetings wherever Professor Yunus was speaking. I called him several times to discuss ways in which we could use McCain resources to contribute to developing a new culture and a new economic system for addressing the world's most challenging problems. I introduced Professor Yunus to the McCain family in Canada, and this allowed me to convince them to build our first social business in Colombia. We focused on what we knew, agriculture, and we created Campo Vivo, a company supporting very poor rural communities. Through training, technical support, access to market, fair buying prices, Campo Vivo facilitates growers' development and participates to poverty eradication. Then we moved to Europe, where we tested the new concept of social business, bringing together several companies to solve a common problem. Food waste were chosen, and we built the first pilot in France, Bon et Bien. Soups were made from misformed and misshaped vegetables and sold in the French retail. Profits were used to train and reintegrate back into the community long-term unemployed people. This project was replicated in Belgium, where we created Envie to tackle food waste and insertion of immigrants into the Belgian society. We also developed social businesses in Greece and Morocco, again to support the rural community. But at 66, I decided to start a new life and to put human beings at the center of my focus. I retired from McCain and I built my own social business, a consulting company that makes money supporting big groups in the CSR field. All the profits are used first to help young entrepreneurs from disadvantaged suburbs to create their own companies, then to develop our social business movement in France. Doing some lobbying at national level, I had the opportunity to work closely with Xavier Bertrand, the president of the Hauts-de-France region. I introduced him to Professor Yunus, and we decided to develop a project to find solutions for all the people who were losing their job because of the bankruptcy of their company during the COVID-19 period. We created an ambitious project named House of the Entrepreneurs in the Hauts-de-France to ease companies' creation in the region. Official launching will take place early September. Of course, social business is a significant part of this project. And during this period, I discovered that many of the potential social business to be created were in the healthcare field or in the service to individuals who are sick, handicapped, or lacking autonomy. In 1946, if you remember, the Constitution of the World Health Organization was adopted and signed by 61 states. The principles set out in the preamble to the Constitution are still valid today, but unfortunately not really implemented. I would like to mention four of them. First one, the enjoyment of the highest attainable standard of health is one of the fundamental rights of every human being, without distinction of race, religion, political belief, economic or social condition. Second one, the health of all people is fundamental to the attainment of peace and security and is dependent on the fullest cooperation of individuals and states. Third one, unequal development in different countries in the promotion of health and control of diseases, especially communicable disease, is a common danger. Remember COVID-19. Fourth one, governments have a responsibility for the health of their people, which can be fulfilled only by the provision of adequate health and social measures. 76 years later, COVID-19 pandemic demonstrated that situation today is far from these nice principles. We live in a world where profit is at the center of the society focus. Our current civilization doesn't care about individuals. Inequalities at healthcare level are huge. Even in the developed countries, they are high and they grow. Some regions, for example, are becoming medical deserts because of the lack of physicians. And the solution chosen in developed countries that import physicians from the poor countries increases the inequalities. We cannot accept this, and we have to react. First, government need to do their job. They have the responsibility for the health of their people. We have the power to get rid of them with our votes if they fail. We can also take the power in many areas, creating social businesses to face specific issues. Of course, creating a company to produce vaccines, for example, is not easy and requires the support of the pharmaceutical industry, at least in the first step. But there are areas where we can immediately act and fix social issues thanks to social business. Services to individuals who are sick, handicapped, or lacking autonomy is an area where we can do a lot. We can find solutions to keep elderly at home as long as we can to avoid parking them in awful retirement homes. We can create companies to support handicapped people and allow them to be fully integrated in our society. We can create companies to support people at home when they are not forced to stay at the hospital after surgery or special medical treatment. There are many things we can do. We have the power to change behaviors and to put individuals at the center of our society. Let's stop talking and let's start acting and building the new civilization now. Thank you very much.
Brilliant. Thanks, Sean. It carries on that central theme raised by Adiba of community participation and control. That's fantastic. And in a world of three zeros that Professor Yunus has been promoting and the Sustainable Development Goals just shows the importance of system-wide and societal-wide thinking when it comes to health and health inequalities. Thanks for that. Our third speaker is Jaime Atienza Ascona, who I think until recently was Chief of Health Financing and is now Director of Equitable Financing at UNAIDS, has also had a sterling career prior to that, working in academia and for Oxfam. So over to you, Jaime. Looking forward to hearing your contribution.
Thank you very much to Professor Yunus that is here with us, to the Yunus Center, and to you all, colleagues, for this fantastic panel. First of all, let me greet everyone from Geneva and send you a message from our executive director, Ms. Winnie Bianjima, that would have liked to be here and asked me to be here on her behalf, because I drive the economic side of the work at UNAIDS. It's very clear for us that this idea of a new civilization that is the overall and overarching framework of this conference is so important. And we do think that there is not only room for change, but need for change. And when we look at health, and before sharing some points, I just want to go back to what precisely Winnie was sharing at the United Nations Conference on Africa, the Economic Conference on Africa, a month ago in Senegal. And she was sharing with finance ministers there and with health ministers there that truly Africans should be angry at what has happened with COVID, because of the lack of access to medicines, because of being pushed back to the end of the line to receive everything, and also because there were not enough economic measures in support of those countries. But she also said, and these are her words, we should be angry at ourselves, because we should have fight and we should have changed to raise more taxes so that we could pay for the health services we want to provide. And we should have also pushed up the investment in health up to the Abuja declaration threshold of 15% of our revenues. So I think that was a nice point, because we were seeing that there is The need for change is in the governance level, it's in the profit versus human rights dilemma, where profit is winning and has been winning in this past crisis, but it's also in the hands of governments, as I think both Adiba and Professor Bernot were saying in their previous interventions. So we have this wide range of situations. Let me share very briefly three points that I wanted to raise today. The first one, I think, has been mentioned: extreme inequality and extreme wealth are part of the problem. We can explain extreme poverty and lack of access to healthcare and to health systems because we have this very unequal economic situation. In UNAIDS, we created or we agreed to a new strategy that's titled Ending Inequalities to End AIDS, because we see that AIDS is pushing to the sides the key populations, and we have managed to get treatment. Professor Kamaruzzaman was saying it took 8 years to get the ARVs to people at the right price. We have to keep fighting because there are new medicines and we need to keep fighting again and again as Sisyphus to get down the prices for the next generation, and we don't have changed the rules. But that happened once, and now we need to see that in order to get things back in track, this needs to continue. That's why the effort of the People's Vaccine Alliance with many, with hundreds of organizations, with some world leaders, and with many developing countries, and you know that South Africa and India have been leaders in this area, has been so important. With COVID, not only lives have been lost, but the economic losses have been massive. And to protect the rights and the profits of just five companies, we have had losses, massive losses for millions of companies, and we have had hundreds of millions of job losses and more poverty. So finally, humanity with these crises has demonstrated that there is the scientific capacity, there is the technical capacity, there is even the infrastructure capacity and the organizational capacity to fight back and get pandemics on track and protect everyone. But we need to change some rules, and this is my final message. This new civilization requires a different governance and different principles. And the principles can no longer be protecting the profit of a small number of companies or sectors. And I say this because during the COVID crisis, we also saw that Africa was having a very large debt crisis. But in the negotiations that were happening at the G20 and that were supported by the IMF, we couldn't see any action by private creditors. So they were taking no action, and they were not helping at all. It was all about governments cutting a little slice of debt or postponing those payments. So we need governance and principles, and to fight inequalities, we need fair taxation, we need effective investments, we need effective health investments, we need to get the value out of every dollar, and to do that with an approach that brings those in the borders to the center, to be the ones that are prioritized. And I share the community-led services that has been mentioned by Professor Kamaruzzaman before. That needs to be part of our health systems that we are building up in many, many geographies. It's the essential piece to bring people to service. And of course, we need to get rid of out-of-pocket expenses, because those are the ones that leave simply people in poverty behind. We need to have social businesses to be promoted as a force of change. And I'm glad to be here in this seminar and this session where this has been already said, because we want to have reasonable profits and to build social value for the society. We need, finally, that financing is put at the service of the rights of the people. So if we need new financing, that's important. We need more grants, we need more donations, we need fair taxation, we need to close tap loopholes, we need companies to pay the fair share, we need those better or those best off in society to pay what is so that those at the bottom can get the right level of services. And finally, let me say that it's important to get leadership. And I would say inspiring leadership, such as the one that Professor Mohamed Yunus brings to us and other leaders bring to us around the world, but also political leadership. We need governments to act, and we need leadership from the South. And let me say that African leadership has been important and inspiring in this crisis, and we need more of that regional and Southern leadership and to push up local production and the kind of reforms that will protect everyone and will allow to get health care and obviously to fight pandemics. And to fight pandemics effectively, we need to finish the ones that exist today, such as AIDS and COVID, that is still with us, and put in place measures that will prevent the future ones. And as I was saying, with the People's Vaccine Alliance, allowing for waivers on intellectual property rights is an essential part of that. Promoting local production of medicines, of treatments, of prevention is also an essential part. Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here with you.
Thank you, Jaime. Very much a common theme now emerging about bottom-up community participation and action. Our fourth speaker is Mitsuru Izumo, who's founder and CEO of Uglena, which is a venture capital company that was, a spin-off from a laboratory at University of Tokyo Faculty of Agriculture. So I will not waste any more time and will leave Mitsuru to tell you all about that. Welcome, Mitsuru.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Donaldson and Professor Yunus. I'm Mitsuru Izumo, the founder of the Uglena Corporation Limited. I'd like to talk about two things, only two things. The first half is my passion for achieving the SDGs. And the last half is the what we do and the current progress in Bangladesh. When I was a student 20 years ago, I visited Bangladesh. At the time, I was a student in the first grade of the University of Tokyo, and I visited Bangladesh as an internship student. The internship program is organized by the Grameen Bank, and I saw the real malnutrition problem there. And I decided that one day I would bring the most nutritious food in Japan to Bangladesh. Nutrition. Anyway, I studied nutrition intensely. And I came to know what Uglena is. You can see Uglena is microorganism. The length is only 0.1 millimeter, a very tiny microorganism. You can see Uglena is green colored. Uglena has chlorophyll. Uglena can do photosynthesis by other other plant. And what makes Uglena unique is that Uglena is a kind of plant. And at the same time, Uglena can move by itself like animal. Uglena has both plant and animal genes. Uglena can produce 59 types of nutrients Uglena can produce at one time. It's the perfect food for solving the malnutrition problem all over the world. But extremely difficult to cultivate in pure sanitized environment. Every kind of bacteria, plankton, insects, birds, human beings, they love to eat Uglena. So it's extremely difficult to cultivate Uglena in a pure sanitized way. I failed 500 experiments. It was really hard work, but I did my best to fulfill my promise to Professor Yunus. And eventually, 2005, I invented the new cultivation method, cultivation liquid to cultivate Uglena on a commercial scale. And set up the company 2005, and the company has grown and now delivers Uglena supplement products to 800,000 Japanese customers every day. We receive 10 cents For every one of our products sold to these 800,000 customers, this is the source of funds that we use to make school lunches containing Ugrena in Bangladesh. Now, we distribute cookies with Ugrena to 10,000 elementary school students every day. Malnutrition has been cured for everyone. We can now do blood tests and health checkups to show that their nutrition has exactly improved. In recognition of this program, we, Ugrena Corporation Limited, became the first Japanese startup company to be selected for the United Nations Rohingya Refugee Camp Food Aid Program. I strongly believe that it's the mission of social entrepreneurs to create a small early success in the most difficult places in the world. I will continue this program no matter what the challenges. I will continue to work with Grameen's social entrepreneurs for achieving SDGs. Let's all work towards our dream of creating a museum of poverty. Thank you for your attention.
Brilliant. Thanks, Mitsuru. And again, it's just such a brilliant example of how taking a very much a system-wide approach can help improve health and well-being more broadly in this world of three zeros and the sustainable development goals. It's just really brilliant. One thing that I've loved over the years is that people like yourself inventing just such ingenious products and then but wanting to promulgate and prosecute these inventions through Professor Eunice's social business model. It's really admirable. Our final speaker in the flesh, so to speak, or on the screen, is Moen Udin Chowdhury. So Moen is Managing Director of Grameen Kalyan, and you'll hear obviously about that from him, but he came to Grameen after years of international experience in finance and strategy. So Moen, we're really looking forward to hearing from you before we move to a little movie from Vanessa Kerry.
Thank you, Cam. I've been hearing all the speakers and very intriguing to see how they are coming up with the inequalities that is happening within this healthcare for the new civilization. I want to touch upon a little bit on my company first before I go into that. Grameen Kalyan is providing primary healthcare in Bangladesh to almost 30 districts, which is almost half the country, and with 140 health centers. We are one of the largest primary healthcare providers, and we are also one of the important social business promoter within the Grameen Group, and where Professor Muhammad Yunus is our chairman. To talk about the inequalities, let me talk within the perspective of Bangladesh. Like, there's a huge shortage of our healthcare professionals. That is something the new civilization is looking at, that what is going to happen in the future. Like, if I give the facts for Bangladesh, for 10,000 patients, we have only 3 doctors. We have only 1 nurse. So this has to be addressed. Like the World Health Organization says that there should be at least 1 doctor per 1,000 patients, or there should be more than 83 nurses for 10,000 patients. But there we are lacking a lot in Bangladesh. Then some of you have already covered on the out-of-pocket expense. In Bangladesh, we don't have universal health coverage, which is the need of the time now, because almost 70% out-of-pocket expense happens within Bangladesh. And for the poor people that we look into, that they cannot afford this treatment if they are continuously paying from their pocket. And current corona situation has shown us the inequality more than anyone else. Then, although we are a developing nation, but our budget is less in terms of healthcare because it's only 5% of the total budget. So where you can see that tertiary level, there are only, this budget is being driven to the tertiary level, it's only 36% of the entire budget. And the secondary level is only 39%. And where the most important part is the primary healthcare, there we have the least, like 25%. So we are looking into that as the private company as to how we can reach to the people in unreached areas where others could not reach. These are very important aspects in terms of inequalities. And we all know that in our country, almost around 6 million people are pushed into the poverty every year, and they cannot afford such treatment. So what the actual civilization is looking at is how do we solve these problems? These are very important and burning issues. Like we need to be careful about this. So from Grameen Group, we tried to do something. We're also coming up with some new strategies, like we are building new skilled workforces. Our Kilindirian College of Nursing is already in operation, one of the largest in Bangladesh and the best one. Then we are having a new hospital very soon, at tertiary level in Dhaka, where we will be treating a lot of patients. Then we will have a medical college where we will prepare more doctors, and also the Health Technology Institute, where we can prepare the skilled workforce. So this is very important, that we need to build more skilled forces for the new civilization. And the other aspect, most of the things are covered. What I was thinking to say is, like, there are artificial intelligence, which is probably giving a lot of precision, but the human touch is absent there. Like the empathy, the care, which is really missing now. If you want to give a quality healthcare, you have to give a lot of care, a lot of empathy to our patient, and that is very important. This is missing. So the next civilization should look at this, and we should be the promoter of all these issues, right? Not only locally, also globally. I think, let me finish it here. Thank you very much, Cam.
Owen, that's brilliant, and it's always good to hear from you personally, but also in these sessions, like, you know, what is actually happening on the ground in key countries like Bangladesh. That was fantastic. Now, I mean, it would be brilliant to be able to have a conversation with this amazing collection of people to think about, right, how do we design a health system and healthcare system going forward? And hopefully that can be a topic for the future. But we do have one more speaker to fit in before we move to Prometheus's surprise. So I don't know if we have the movie available from Dr. Vanessa Carey. Vanessa is from Harvard Medical School. She's a great friend of social business, and is founder of a social business called Seed Global Health. And we have a recorded speech from Vanessa to listen to now.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It's an honor to be here with you today and with these panelists who are extraordinary to have a critical discussion about our future and where we are going as a world and what we need to do. The conversations taking place today are some of the most important we could be having. We face existential challenges to human well-being at every turn. We are in our third year of a global pandemic. We see increasing and accelerated threat from climate change. We are ravaged by conflict and war on several continents, which are changing our trust, security, and global engagement. And the wealth gap continues to grow daily. At the base of all of these, though, are the inequity gaps that are growing. Those already most vulnerable are hardest hit by the challenges we face today. And COVID-19 is a dramatic example. It has affected us all, but it disproportionately continues to damage the health and well-being of populations in low and middle-income countries, and including the critical health protections needed. Throughout this pandemic, we have seen increased food insecurity, reduced access to healthcare worldwide, reversal of progress in maternal and child mortality, as well as in infectious and chronic diseases and disruptions of essential services like vaccinations and HIV care. We have seen ongoing vaccine inequity, which has threatened the lives, health, and well-being of individuals and families, and stymied economic recovery in low-income countries, where only 11% of the population has received a single vaccine dose, compared to 90% in high-income countries. As many look to recovery or to our future, we must look well beyond COVID. COVID can actually, though, be a catalyst for creating fundamental changes in the systems, values, and justice necessary for our collective well-being. We cannot build back just better, a UN coined term. We must build back transformatively, truly differently, prioritizing investments in the fundamentals of human sustainability, including health or the health workforce that is so essential to protecting it. Health is central to our individual, community, national, and global security. It is central to social inclusion and gender equity. It is justice and human dignity. COVID has laid bare the fundamental importance of health, but it has also spotlighted how we have failed to uphold this health, despite almost 50 years of increasing investment and discussion about it. And the global community has chronically neglected one of the most critical foundations of health systems, the trained health workforce, and we are suffering for it. As COVID has overwhelmed the world, we are now failing to make progress in health. We are actually seeing negative returns on previous investments. COVID has worsened health inequities. 90% of countries have seen disruptions in essential services, whether in immunization outreach, non-communal disease management, family planning. We've seen 4 times of polio cases in polio endemic countries with vaccine disruptions. And of course, these disruptions are worse in lower and middle income countries. These threats and reversals have only accelerated in COVID. And perhaps one of the places worse has been among the healthcare workforce. Prior to COVID, we already faced a global shortage of 18 million healthcare workers, worst in 47 countries, 33 of which are in sub-Saharan Africa. But today we have lost at least an additional 180,000 healthcare workers who have died. And there are many more who have left the system, tired, exhausted. And there has been applause, but there has not been the systemic, large-scale, and bold action needed globally to reverse these trends. We have an opportunity to look critically at these challenges and invest strategically for the well-being of all. The workforce, for Seed Global Health, the organization I run, focuses, really is somewhere we believe is a poignant example. We know strong health systems founded on a robust and well-trained workforce can undergird climate resilience, tackling the additional 250,000 deaths a year anticipated from climate change. They can serve as a backbone of pandemic preparedness and a front line of surveillance. They are a response to outbreaks and can address the existing burdens of disease, offering continuity and care, bridging the last mile along the referral chain and protecting essential services. Investments in the workforce are also a foundation for economic growth, recovery, and job creation, a path to social inclusion, creating jobs for women, and ensuring investment in education and health for communities. We can no longer tolerate arguments that investments in the workforce are too expensive. They are quite the opposite. They pay for themselves. Research has continually shown economic benefit to investments in the workforce, including a return on investment on the low side of 9 to 1 and on the high side as high as 50 to 1. At Seed, we believe deeply that health workers are the heart of health systems and critical to sustainability, resilience, and equity. And we have partnered with governments to fill those gaps and train a rising generation of health providers who can provide care, train their successors, be agents of change, and be on the front line of our security, protection, and well-being. And through a combination of on-the-ground work and advocacy, we are promoting the importance of health through modeling, through better care, saving lives, and by deeply linking these two from the ground to policy, we are going to build resilience and deep partnership. Seed is committed to partner with all of you towards a better future, towards changing the status quo. Because as we engage in the work on the ground, we are going to continue and are committed to challenging global stakeholders and the accompanying dysfunctional historic power dynamics to adopt new approaches to health system strengthening, which prioritize investments in the human capacity required to deliver care and to ensure our human sustainability and well-being for years to come. Thank you. Good morning, good afternoon.
Brilliant. I think that's a really strong message to finish the session on, is how do we grow and sustain those who are right at the front line of all this around the world, our health workforce. Absolutely fantastic presentation there from, as I said, a great friend of the social business community, Vanessa Carey. This group has so much to contribute that I'm just amazed that we even kept approximately to time, but we don't have any time for further questions, unfortunately. And I, as has come through strongly in the chat, I think what people, I think, would like to see going forward is groups of amazing contributors like this now thinking about how can we collect those thoughts together to design some sort of healthcare and health system going forward. And I think what you've seen today is that from the contributions that we've had from our panel, that would be possible. People, our panel is just so positive about this, but also that it's that it would be a very exciting thing to develop as well. So it just remains for me to thank our panel for your contributions. And I just want to hand back to Prometheus for this intriguing invitation that he gave us to hang on at the end of the session for a special surprise. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Cam. Just before, before we go to the special surprise, could I please request Cam and all the panelists to please turn on your cameras along with Professor Eunice as well. We will do a quick photo capture for our memories, if that's all right. And I request the tech team to do that as well. Just a picture of the whole this illustrious group of panelists and Professor Eunice and Lamia and everyone else, please. Thank you. And the tech team, please do advise us when that's been done already. So of all the panelists who are here, if you wouldn't mind turning on your cameras. Okay. Is it done, Aziz?
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. I will now move on to a bit of a surprise that we have for Professor Eunice. And as Lamia had said yesterday, and we're reflecting on that today as well, a central part of the getting together, all the family coming together on this particular day, with the 28th of June, which stems back another 12 years, is a lot of you may already be aware, it's actually Professor Eunice's birthday today. So there's been a host of messages coming our way. And I thought that whilst we have this great panel with us and all the audiences chimed in, this would be a good opportunity and a heartfelt one as well for us to share some of those with Professor Eunice and the audience. So with Professor Eunice's permission, I'd like to first share the message we've got from Mairead McGuire, who's the 1976 Nobel Peace Laureate. She sent through this message where she says, "Dear Professor Mohammed Yunus, many, many congratulations to you, dear Eunice, on your 82nd birthday. May you continue to spread love, hope to everyone with your inspirational work. Peace and love, Mairead McGuire, the 1976 Nobel Peace Laureate." So this was a message from a fellow Nobel Peace Prize winner. Next, we've got a greetings all the way from the Eunice Social Business Foundation in Taiwan. I request the tech team to please play the audiovisual. Thank you.
Hello, happy birthday, Professor Yunus.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to Dr. Yunus.
Hello, Professor Yunus. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Professor Yunus, happy birthday. 生日快乐.
Professor Yunus,
happy birthday.
Professor Yunus, happy birthday. Wish all your birthday wishes and dreams come true.
Professor Yunus,
happy birthday!
Thank you very much. So hard work.
Wonderful. What a heartwarming message. Thank you, sir. We will now move on to the next one, which is again from one of a fellow Nobel Peace Prize winner. It's from Malala Yousafzai and her father, Ziauddin Yousafzai as well. And Malala writes, "We want to send the warmest birthday greetings to Professor Yunus on his birthday on behalf of Malala and Ziauddin, and a very good luck to the 12th Social Business Day." Thank you for that. We deeply thank Malala and her father for sharing this message. Now we move on to a message from a Bangladeshi Australian who's gained quite a bit of notoriety over the last 12 months or so. She was one of the top three participants of MasterChef Australia. She was greatly inspired by Professor Yunus's work as well. And they had an opportunity to meet lately. And we have a message from her, which is Kishwar Chaudhary, one of the three finalists of MasterChef Australia 2021. So if we could have Kishwar's video.
Happy birthday, Professor Yunus. What an incredible journey and life to be celebrated. You have inspired millions like me across the globe as a change maker, instilling hope and striving to create a world better than when you found it. I'm wishing you so much love and prosperity as you celebrate your 82nd birthday. Happy birthday, Professor Yunus.
Perfect. What a heartfelt message from Kishwar as well. Next, from Australia, we move back into Asia, and we've got a video from our colleagues in Philippines as well, who all got together in a room to wish Professor Yunus the very best on his birthday. If he could have, please have the video from the Philippines. Thank you, everyone, for your patience. We're just giving...
Greetings, sir, from Manila. We've got all our colleagues here who want to give you a message. What do we have to say, guys?
Happy birthday, Professor Yunus from Ramin, Pilipinas.
Perfect. We now, from the Philippines, we move on to Malaysia. Mai Harapan, one of the greatest supporters of the social business ecosystem in Malaysia. And we've got a video from one of our dear colleagues, Nini, and her team. The next one is from Mai Harapan.
Beautiful, beautiful, no other name I knew from the moment you came. I see in your eyes the dawn of a day when nothing will ever be the same. I wanna sing for you, yeah, I'll sing for you. Happy birthday, baby. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Prof. Yunus!
Thank you. Thank you very much from all our colleagues in Malaysia. What I will do right now is move on to, we've got a host of other videos, which I'm sure we'll get to share with Professor Yunus throughout the day. But the at this point in time, the one that we really, really want to share is from a very gifted young man who Professor Yunus knows very well, and I thought we should all, if we could please have the beautiful and heartwarming father, and which is for us to see as well. So if we could please cue Cyrus's birthday greetings.
Happy birthday, Nana. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Nana. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Nana. Now, I have one more song for you. This song is from the movie Willy Wonka, and I'm Charlie, so I'm gonna work on this song. Now, come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin, traveling in a world of your creation. What we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world? There's nothing to it. There is no place I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. Happy birthday, Nana.
Thank you.
What a wonderful message from Cyrus. And that song that he shared, I think, also greatly inspires us to do the work that we are doing. So this was for you, sir. Just a few messages which have come through. I'm sure we'll share quite a bit of it as well. And with that, we'll call in official.
You should mention that Cyrus is his grandson. I don't know if everyone knows.
Yes, that. I've done that. Yes. So Cyrus is Professor Yunus's grandson, an incredibly gifted young person. So with that, we'll call an official close to the first panel. Again, our deepest gratitude to all the panelists who have joined us. And thank you for staying tuned in for this surprise. I hope it's sort of enlightened us a bit more, encouraged us a bit more, set a bit of a happy note for us to go throughout the day as well. And we'll all join us again. We've already about to start the next session. So we'll see you there. So once you go back to your tickets, we will join you there again. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.